Big Church is ready. Hi, everybody. Happy Sunday. It's noon. It's March 29th. And sorry, gosh, I have a very noisy fire behind me. And we just wanted to give an update because Jake Deutsch, who was one of the first doctors I interviewed on Instagram Live, who runs the health clinic in New York City, actually came down with corona. He's doing better. We thought it might be helpful to have some positive news from a doctor who's recovering or almost recovered. So he'll be joining us momentarily. I thought I'd give you the latest statistics, you guys, on the number of cases. There are over 684,000, close to 685,000 worldwide, almost 125,000 cases in the United States, 834 total deaths in the United States. I thought there were more than that. We're going to double check how many in the United States. I thought there were, okay, they say 834. We're using the Johns Hopkins tracker. You can check the cases. 53,520 is in the U.S.
This is in the U.S.
In the U.S., 125,313. And, of course, doctors say that for every case that's been diagnosed, there are probably five or six other people who also have the disease. So let's see if we get Jake in here because I want to just check in with him. Hi, Jake. You there? A friend of mine, it said he was ready above when we started. A friend of mine just texted me that a friend of hers died early this morning. He waited for 13 hours in the emergency room while he was waiting to go into the intensive care unit and could not get in. So that's very disconcerting. And let me see if we have Jake, Dr. Deutsch, coming in here. We're going to text him, you guys, and see where he is. 884 deaths were in New York City. Hi, everyone. Let's see if Dr. Deutsch is here. Hi, Amanda. I've been enjoying your Instagram stories. Amanda Haas. Trying to see where he is. I mean, this is modern technology, isn't it, ladies and gentlemen? You kind of deal with that on television. You just never saw it. Here, hold on. Sorry, you guys. I'm sorry about this delay. We've been having a little trouble with our Instagram lives, and I don't know whether we have a Wi-Fi situation or what the deal is. Did he say he was coming on?
Yep. I don't know.
He's trying. Hi, Leslie Cogburn. Leslie follows me on Instagram, so I often see her comments. Anyway, I think at a time like this, we need some sense of community. And if you guys want me to talk to any other people about, oh, here's Jake. See if we can get him on the line or on the phone or whatever you call it. He's connecting.
Good, yeah.
Hi, Jake.
Yep. Hi.
Hey, how are you?
Okay, take care. All right, bye. I'm okay. How are you? Sorry,
I'm
just
good.
Talking to the patient.
Oh no, well that's more important than talking to me now. I know.
No, we're good. It's a person who had corona. They're doing better. So we like those phone calls.
Well, tell me. So, and we won't take too long. I know Governor Cuomo is speaking now and a lot of people want to hear what he has to say, but
yeah.
Jake, are you back at work now?
Yeah, I'm at work.
Hi. How are you all?
Kiara and Kim.
Hi, Kim. Tell everyone what you do. Jake, because some people probably didn't hear me talk about what your job was.
I'm an ER doctor. I'm board certified in emergency medicine, and I have an urgent care practice. So I'm seeing patients in the urgent care today. So we're just, you know, basically, you know, open for business. We're taking care of mostly people that have corona symptoms, but, you know, really more of the milder cases. So, you know, a lot of people are coming in because they need to be tested. They're healthcare workers, they're police officers, they're basically, you know, working still, and they want to make sure that they're not sick, that they're good to continue working.
That so they're not spreading the virus, right?
Right. So we're really able to help the essential workers, you know, make a determination if they're good to do what they're doing.
And Jake, where is your clinic? Can I ask that?
Sure. Yeah, we're in Manhattan. We're in New York City. We have an office on the Upper West Side and the Upper East Side. It's called Cure Urgent Care.
And so you yourself got, someone said, thanks. Thank you for your hard work and commitment.
Thanks.
You were one of the first doctors I talked to, Jake, when this happened.
Yeah.
And tell me what happened in terms of your own illness.
Yeah, so, you know, we were seeing patients which we thought were going to be corona positive before we had a test. So, and you know, we had no idea about any personal protection, and we were basically just testing people as if they had regular flu. No masks, you know, washing our hands obviously and that, but not really protected. And you know, once we started seeing some cases here in New York, I started to get sick. And luckily we were able to get testing. We have about 100 tests per office each day that we're able to do.
Wow.
So I was able to get myself tested. In 2 days, I had the result, and I tested positive. And, you know, it was definitely scary, but everybody, you know, was kind of in the understanding, oh, I'm going to get better. And it lingered for a week. I had low-grade fever, but I was still, like, eating. And at a week, I was like, whoa, something is not right. So basically, at that point, I checked myself into the hospital at Mount Sinai. Where I had, you know, I'm very well connected there. They're my partners in my urgent care. And I have privileges there as, you know, ER attending. And basically, I had to be treated like a patient, which was the scariest day for me that I can remember as a doctor. I mean, I'm very familiar with emergency rooms, and, you know, I've spent 13 years of my professional life in the ER as an attending doctor. And I just remember being there and being so scared, and, you know, the anxiety and the stress and just the, you know, the feeling was horrible. And they shot my x-ray. They did a portable x-ray, and the technician walked away. And I was like, let me see that. And I was like, I have pneumonia. I can see I have pneumonia. And they were like, well, you know, you tell me, doc. And just sitting there, and, you know, like, everything was really difficult for them. I mean, they were amazing, everybody, what they're doing. But it was just, you know, not the normal organization that we're used to.
Right.
And luckily, my oxygen levels were okay. They did some blood work, which was okay. And then the doctor sent me home. But, you know, I got to say, like, I was sitting there as a patient and felt so vulnerable and so uncertain. And here I am, probably one of the most informed, you know, sort of, you know, people in the situation, and just feeling helpless myself.
What was it? Wait, so how long did you stay in the hospital, and what was the atmosphere like in the ER? Were you in the ER, or were you admitted right away?
No, just in the emergency department. You know, I was there for about 4 hours. And, you know, once I knew that my oxygen was okay and that, you know, my blood work looked okay, and I had the doctor, like, sort of talk with me and sort of talk me off of a ledge, you know, he basically was like, you're going to, you know, maybe get a little bit worse, but we're going to send you home. And I wanted to go home. I also, you know, two other things. One, I knew that I needed to start the hydroxychloroquine.
Uh-huh.
So I had that at home. So I wanted to kind of get home to start that. So I started that, and I took the antibiotic, the azithromycin. And, you know, I just felt like I needed to be home. But still, it was very unsettling. Simultaneously, my father is sick. He's in the ICU in Las Vegas.
Oh, geez.
Yeah, and he subsequently has gotten put on a ventilator, and he tested positive. So I was, you know, dealing with that that stress of dealing with my father not getting better. Thank God he's slowly improving, which is, you know, the best news possible. But, you know, I just, it was a lot going on, dealing with my work and making sure that we were able to operate, keeping our staff safe, getting PPE. You know, it was just a culmination of everything simultaneous, which, you know, just an unexplainable levels of stress.
I'm sure. Are all patients getting that combination drug?
I know.
So do you think they should be? And, you know, I know that you have to be extremely careful because that can have some cause inflammation and all sorts of things. So what is going on with sort of using that?
Yeah. So, you know, basically it's being reserved for people that are really sick. So the people that are developing pulmonary symptoms and pneumonia is who it should be reserved for. You know, when I left the ER, the doctor that saw me was like, if you have it, I guess you should take it. But it wasn't like there was any sort of definitive instruction. And, you know, we don't want people just going out and getting it and stockpiling it, because most people have mild symptoms. I mean, I'm seeing about 30 to 45% of the patients we test positive, but for the most part, everybody is just being treated at home and they're resolving in 5 to 7 days. Some people, you know, not even a day or two of symptoms.
My nephew is in his early 40s, super healthy. He lives in Los Angeles. He got it. And I've heard this from other people. He was feeling better. And then he sort of took a nosedive and started feeling worse again. At one point, he was very concerned because he was coughing up blood.
Yeah.
And he called his doctor and had a consult with him over the phone. He's feeling better now.
Right.
But I've heard that, Jake, you feel better and then you kind of take a nosedive, feel worse, and then better again. It's a bit of a roller coaster, the recovery process. Did you experience that?
Absolutely. At 1 week, I was like, something's not right. And, you know, the hard part is how do these people know, okay, something's not right, I need to go to the hospital, or something's not right, I'm going to get better in a day or two. So that's, and then,
that's,
you know,
that's what I keep asking people, this inflection point. You know, people want to stay home. They don't want to clog up the healthcare system, but they don't want to wait so long that they're seriously ill.
Right. So, you know, the best advice is, number one, I always tell people, we know when we need to, like, kind of go to the hospital. You know, there's something that we call triage, where we, you know, when people come in, we figure out how sick they are. You know, you get assessed and then we triage you. Okay, this is a serious acute problem or this is minor. People kind of auto triage based on, you know, what you feel. So that's probably the most important thing. You know, if you are feeling, all right, I am not right, I cannot breathe, I have serious pain in my chest, my lips are blue, you know, like, you're going to pick up on those cues and be like, I am not good. But for other people that are just not better and maybe just feel kind of crummy at a week, there's a large part of the population that the symptoms linger. And we need to be able to kind of balance out that something isn't right versus, okay, I'm just lingering.
Did you have a fever, Jake? A lot of people are asking if you had a fever.
Yeah, so I had, even at a week, I was still having 99 temp. 99, 100, 100.2. So I was still really expressing symptoms. I think that if you're not expressing those symptoms, the fevers have gone after 3 days, that you're less likely to be having more of the severe reaction, because fever is an indication that our body is an immune response, that it's reacting to something still persistently within our body. So that would be a good indicator. Without fever, unlikely, but there's no definite prescription. You know, we don't have a format to be following 100% of the time. So, you know, in a situation, if there was a little bit of uncertainty, maybe it's an urgent care, you know. And like, we're doing telemedicine, so people are calling all day long, and we're still like doing a telephone consultation for many people to avoid them from coming in. But you know, maybe if you're not so sick, but you needed an x-ray and check your oxygen, an urgent care might be an option for people as well.
Someone just said they have no sense of smell or taste, and I know that's one of the symptoms. And the person said, should I be concerned?
No, I mean, that's like almost pathognomonic, meaning like a surefire positive diagnosis. So I would just assume that you've been exposed and you're positive, but it gets better. It's just there's inflammation of the nasal passages where the nerves are and also the taste buds that prohibits people to have a normal sense of smell and taste, but that resolved. But assume that that's positive. And also, you know, the diarrhea.
Yeah, a lot of people are asking about GI symptoms.
Yeah, it's the diarrhea is almost always going to be a sign that you were exposed to.
Really? So the symptoms, again, are often sore throat. Is that right?
A burning sore throat, the, you know, dry cough, the fatigue, like, you know, severe fatigue, the back aches, the muscle pains, and then diarrhea is one of them. And sense of smell, definitely, and taste. But also, I've noticed a lot of people have had, like, kind of burning on their skin, which is one of the symptoms that I had as well.
Burning on your skin?
Yeah, like, in my torso, it just felt like my skin was super sensitive. The shirt on my chest was irritating.
Oh, interesting. You know, people are asking, how do they treat themselves at home? Which is a good question. You know, inevitably, I understand whenever I do these, people are obviously have a million questions. Yeah. One, you know, I always get asked about the ibuprofen. I mean, the doctors do.
Yeah.
And versus Tylenol. And someone's asking about nasal spray, humidifier. I mean, basically, can you just give us some tips for how you treat this at home?
I mean, most of it's going to be what we call supportive care. So anything that makes you feel better. Fever is the most important thing to be treating, because even the low-grade temperature of 99, you're going to feel lousy from that. So taking something for the fever consistently is the key. And I use Tylenol. You know, I just was being cautious based on whatever we knew. So, you know, and my temperature responded beautifully to it. I felt good when I took it. So I kept it on Tylenol. But otherwise, symptomatically, you know, anything like a cough medication you could take, anything that helps open up your sinuses, Vicks, you know, any sort of decongestant like Sudafed or Mucinex. So all of that is fair game. You know, there's really nothing that you're going to take that's going to be harmful. And the fever, I always explain to patients, whether it's corona or flu or strep, you know, a temperature makes us feel real bad. So, you know, a lot of times people aren't even addressing that because, you know, they just aren't informed. And something as simple as Tylenol can really get you off the couch, can give you that, you know, sort of pep in your step and an important indicator that you are all right and you're doing okay.
So you said just to be safe, this ibuprofen debate is kind of keeps popping up. From the literature you've read, Jake, is it something you should avoid?
There's never been any other viral illness that we've been instructed not to take ibuprofen. So it just, that's the only information that I can go on. But in a situation, you know, like, why would you take it unless you needed it? You know, Tylenol works sufficiently. We just want to make sure people aren't overdosing on Tylenol. Tylenol in large doses can be toxic to our liver. So, you know, if you're on medications which are potentially an interaction with Tylenol, you want to be careful. But, you know, I think that sticking to that is going to be the purest approach until we have some really controlled studies about what that interaction looks like and what we need to be worried about. But I think in the big picture, I mean, there's so much else that we want to be giving as information, you know, spreading to people about staying home, about isolating, you know, being responsible, because it is everywhere. This is not just New York. This is not just LA. This is not just Louisiana. It is everywhere. And we need to treat it like that. And we need to be responsible so that we can see progress. We can see the hospitals being able to treat the people who need it and keep people healthy.
Well, speaking of that, a friend of mine texted me that her friend died this morning because he was waiting for 13 hours in the emergency room.
Yeah, and we're going to see horrible
So like what this. The hell is that about? I mean, is it just these ERs are so overrun?
Yeah. I mean, on a busy day, on a, you know, a bad day in the ER, we might see 300 patients. And that's, you know, bootstrapping. I can only imagine what the volumes are looking like now, 500, 600 patients. I mean, there's just a point of loss of control that is inevitable. And that's where people need to understand. Yeah, I had a mild symptom. I'm feeling okay. I don't need to be worried. You do, because it's the people that are in that situation that we can't take care of. You know, it's that it translates to that problem. And that's where everybody needs to understand that, you know, this is much greater than just your own circumstance. It's the community. It's our livelihood of the people who are best taking care of people that are being worst hit and affected by this. So unfortunately, we're going to have situations like that that are going to be horrible stories.
You know, I think it's worth asking you again, because some people are joining this late, and that is, how did you know, Jake, you needed to go to the hospital?
I felt so bad at a week. I still was having fevers, and I started getting tight in my chest. And I needed to know what my x-ray looked like and check my oxygen level. So that was the key. But, you know, it's not an easy answer to give because everybody's so anxious right now. But, you know, if you're better after 5 days, you're not running fevers, you're not coughing, you don't have any tightness, you're probably not in that category.
And if you're at home and you find yourself having any of these symptoms, should you isolate from the rest of your family?
I mean, if you've been in the same household with somebody and you've been isolating and then you start to get symptoms, you've all been exposed. So at that point, everybody should just be 14 days. That doesn't really make a difference if you, you know, just got sick and then you're going to go sit in another room isolated. It's impossible not to have already exposed each other. But everybody's going to handle that differently in terms of what they want to do personally. But, you know, this is not a difficult germ to spread. And if you're in the same household and you're, you know, touching the same counters, unless you've had some sort of strict precautions, you're going to be exposed to your family. So unfortunately, that means everybody.
I have to ask you this because I've gotten so many people inquiring about this, Jake. Many people have said, now that you've had this, are you immune? Yes. Are you immune from getting it again? Or do we just not know that yet?
I mean, we have to assume that we are. Coronaviruses typically, you know, have the immunity at least for a season. You know, there's nothing we could do besides assume from what we know. And, you know, I'm back seeing patients. We're using all of the precautions that we need to when we see each other, you know, see patients covering our using masks. And luckily we have access to that, but we won't know. But, you know, you got to have faith that based on what we have as knowledge, that it is going to confer immunity. I was able to test myself again. I did come back negative, which was encouraging. But, you know, we're going to learn each day, each week, more information about what we need to do. But, you know, we can't live in a world where we can't then ever be exposed in any form. You know, that's just an impossibility.
What about this Abbott Labs test that has just come out and been FDA approved in an emergency order or whatever? They said they could distribute something like 50, or make, I could get, I have this wrong, but they can distribute or make 50,000 a day or something like that. But you can get the results in less than around 15 minutes.
That's so amazing.
How have you heard about that, Jake? And how might
I haven't? I would,
situation?
Yeah, I'm assuming it's like a rapid flu test. You know, we use rapid flu tests in the office that we're able to get the results in that time period. So it's probably of that nature. But I don't know much about what Abbott is working on.
If that happens and people have access to it, how might it change the situation?
Well, I mean, in some some states, people are waiting 5 days. And unfortunately, people are not taking it seriously while they're waiting. If we're able to rapidly test people, get more people to understand, you know, maybe that'll be a big drive to change people's behavior more. So I think that that's where it's critical. I, you know, unfortunately, in other parts of the country, people are still, you know, acting as if there's nothing to be worried about.
It's insane. And asthmatics, I often have a lot of people tuning into these who have asthma. Then I'm going to let you go because I know you have a lot of things to do and a lot of patients to care for. Asthmatics are particularly susceptible. I interviewed a doctor in New Orleans yesterday who's asthmatic.
Yeah.
And it was very, very worrisome for her. And she told me that that healthcare providers are not being prioritized for ventilators, which was another thing that was really upsetting.
Yeah, I mean, those are probably all anecdotal stories, so I can't comment on that. But yeah, asthma is definitely something to be more cautious with. And, you know, again, the symptoms aren't necessarily synonymous with having a pre-existing diagnosis. I've seen plenty of people with asthma who've had minor symptoms. So, you know,
that's good to know. I think you're putting a lot of people at ease because I think asthmatics are particularly concerned about this.
And the other thing, Katie, I mean, I know that this is probably a little off topic, but people need to tune out a little bit. You know, I speak to a lot of patients who have a lot of anxiety. They're watching CNN 24/7. And it's important, you know, maybe check in once a day. But I don't think that it's healthy for us to just be perseverating on this because it's only giving people more negative feedback.
Right.
And I think that it's important to just unplug a little bit.
I think that's such good advice. You know, we have a morning newsletter called Wake Up Call. And then on Instagram, I sort of do the most important points of the day so people can know what's going on, but they don't have to be tuned in 24/7. And so we're working really hard to give people the important information they need. And we're also
all these DJs are doing, you know, like live DJ sets. Last night we had a dance party. Go on my story. You'll see me and Brian dancing around watching my friend DJ live. Like that was so important. You know what I mean? And everybody was connecting on a different level. So just, I really want to, I mean, it's not medicine. It's just humanity. Just make sure that people are connecting and unplugging to some degree right now.
That is so true, Jake. Check in with friends who live alone. And also just check in on your neighbors to make sure they're okay. Lori Gottlieb, who's a psychotherapist in LA, who does the Atlantic column called Dear Therapist. She's going to be joining me at 2:00. So if anybody has anxiety issues or mental health concerns and need some advice from a therapist and can't get to one, definitely tune in at 2:00. Jake, a million thanks. Please DM me if there's something you think our followers need to know about.
Yeah, I'm glad to check in regularly. I think that it's, you know, every little point of positive information is helpful. And I think what you're doing is amazing. You know, we need more people that are using these platforms to spread the information that's useful.
Well, that's what I'm trying to do because I went into journalism as a public service. So I hope that I'm providing that for some people in this crazy time. Jake, get to your patients. I'm glad you're feeling better. Please tell your whole team.
Guys,
thank you. Ladies. Thank you for all you're doing.
Yeah, they're amazing.
Thank you.
I couldn't be so proud.
We so appreciate you all. Thank you. And please take care of yourself.